Good morning, everyone. Hear these words from Psalm 63. O God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you. My soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you in this parched and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in your sanctuary and gazed upon your power and glory. Your unfailing love is better than life itself. How I praise you. I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. You satisfy me more than the richest feast. I will praise you with songs of joy. I hope you've come hungry for more of him. I hope you've come ready to offer your praises and songs of thanksgiving and your attention to him. I greet you in Christ's name. If you're a guest with us live or on live stream, we invite you to go to our website and let us know you're out there so we can interact with you and send you a little gift. We do welcome those joining us via live stream. I encourage you to stay with us today. We're going to be talking about the challenge to grow spiritually. Too many shallow Christians in the world, and God has more in store for us than that. So it's going to be a great day. So glad you're here. For those who are live, we decided to start making these notes, pages available, fill in, so they're on the back table with pens. If that helps you be more attentive and retain the content, so that's there for you. I invite you to stand as we confess together. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ is coming again.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you for this opportunity you've given us to gather in your name. We know that not everyone has this freedom, but we have exercised our rights and our will to be in your house, Lord. But that's not all we're praying for. We're praying for encounter with you. We are hungry, Lord. We are thirsty for your real presence. So would you draw near to us today? Would you bless everyone here and who's participating on our live stream, God? Make every home a sanctuary, I pray. Enable us to push aside the cares and concerns of our daily lives, to focus on you, to give you your worth. Just be glorified in this place. Love you and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Remain standing as we worship the Lord.
Thank you. worthy. Amen? Amen. It says, I've waited patiently for the Lord, and he has heard my cry. He lifted me out of the pit of despair, out of the muck and the mire, and set my feet on solid ground. Can anyone testify to that this morning? Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Oh,
take a moment, Lord, to breathe in the life that you gave us this morning and your love that meets no end, Lord, and that has no match in all of this universe. Lord, we just pray that you would make your spirit real and known to us this morning as we are overwhelmed, Lord, by your spirit and your love. And we just pray that you would be with the message this morning that Pastor brings us as we yearn to get deeper into your word, Lord, and to grow, that you wouldn't have us stay the way that we are, but, Lord, to continue to improve and become more like you. That is our desire this morning. So help us, Lord, to have a heart that's willing to change, ears that are willing to listen, and eyes that are willing to see what you would have for us. And in all of these things we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
It's like this is deja vu. Hey guys, how y'all doing? I guess you're probably wondering what I'm doing up here. Well, Pastor Dave has asked me to share my story with you guys, so I guess I should start by saying my name is Shaw Lowe, and let's see where to begin. Well, I love Jesus. Well, okay. Maybe the love is faded just a bit and it's kind of worn off, but I do like him a lot, actually. Let's see where to begin. I guess my story starts about 3 years ago. I was sitting in a seat just like the one you guys are sitting in, and I was listening to Pastor Dave give the gospel presentation when it hit me this time. You see, I had heard him give the story about, I don't know, maybe a dozen times before. But that day was different. That day I realized that I was lost and that I was a sinner and that I needed Jesus and God to help me find the peace that I was looking for. I needed a savior. So I prayed the prayer. And when I did, I felt the weight of my sin just coming up and off of me. It was amazing. It was the best day of my life. I will never forget how I felt that day. I felt free. I had the joy, and I had this peace that I can't really explain. Best day of my life. I kind of wish those feelings would have lasted longer, you know? Let's see. So I guess since that day, my life has been normal, I guess. I come to church when I can get up on Sundays and when there's not football, you know. What else? I pray every day. Well, okay, at least for my meals. One time I invited a coworker of mine to come to church with me, but he couldn't come. And he's kind of bummed out. For the last 3 years, I have been volunteering for the church mowing team. This year, I decided, however, it really wasn't my thing, so I'm going to let somebody else volunteer this year. Let's see what else. Oh, when you guys are, you know, when you're scrolling through your Facebook and you come across those really cool, inspirational posts, you know, the kind I'm talking about, the kind that give you all warm and fuzzy and you really like it. I love those things, and if they're good enough, I'll even repost them. Do you know what, though? I gotta be honest. I haven't been feeling very close to God lately. I don't know that you can blame me, really, though. Because of the pandemic, I didn't get my annual raise like I always do. My car's been in the shop like 4 or 5 times already this year. And don't even get me started with the derecho, man. thank God for insurance, but I was out $2,500 thanks to all the damage that it caused. It's not really that either. There's more. I keep asking God to send me somebody, but I'm still alone. I don't want to be single, but I am. Sure, I've had a few dates every now and then, and I've even gone to the bar a few times, but nothing's lasted, you know? But hey, I just got to keep trying, right? Like the good book says, God helps those who help themselves, right? I even emailed Pastor Dave a few weeks ago asking him for help because he's really good with that. And he did send me a few scriptures, and I'm sure they'll help. I really haven't got around to looking at those yet. He even encouraged me to do this thing, to come to this thing that they call like prayer gathering. If you guys heard about these, they're kind of strange. Maybe a little too extreme for me. I don't know if I'm into all that. But hey, I'm doing better than most. Me and the big guy are okay. So as long as my life doesn't get any worse, I'll be fine. So yeah, I think that's about it. Yep, that's the story of Shiloh. Thanks, guys.
We have some shallow soil to tend to today. As we journey through the parable of the sower, to acknowledge that spiritual shallowness, spiritual immaturity seems an epidemic in the church today. We need to go deeper, and I really think most of us want to go deeper. We want more of God. We want greater intimacy with Him. But maybe we feel like, you know, about spiritual maturity like we do about, you know, biological maturity or adulting, they call it today. What being an adult feels like. You know, we don't want all the responsibility. We don't want the burden of having to do the right thing all the time. I can relate with this. Childhood injuries, fell off my bike, fell out of a tree, twisted my ankle. Adult injuries, slept wrong, sat down too long, sneezed too hard. Adulting is overrated. Can I get an amen? Amen. That horrifying moment when you're looking for an adult for help, but then realize that you are an adult. I have no idea what I'm doing, and at this point, I'm too afraid to ask. And we've all had those days. We just don't feel like adulting. We don't feel like putting effort into a relationship with Jesus Christ. But we're suffering the consequences. We're not flourishing. We're not bearing fruit like He wants us to. Let's turn back to Mark chapter 4. And we'll be looking at verses 3 through 17 this morning. And I invite you to stand for the reading of the word. Mark 4, beginning with verse 3. Jesus says, "Listen, a farmer went out to plant some seeds, and he scattered it across his field. As he scattered it across his field, some of the seed fell on a footpath, and the birds came and ate it. Other seed fell on shallow soil with underlying rock. The seed sprouted quickly because the soil was shallow. But the plant soon wilted under the hot sun, and since it didn't have deep roots, it died. Other seed fell among the thorns that grew up and choked out the tender plants, so they produced no grain. Still other seed fell on fertile soil, and they sprouted, grew, and produced a crop that was 30, 60, or even 100 times as much as had been planted. Then he said, 'Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand.' Later, when Jesus was alone with the 12 disciples and with the others who were gathered around, they asked him what the parables meant. He replied, 'You are permitted to understand the secret of the kingdom of God, but I use parables for everything I say to outsiders, so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. When they see what I do, they will learn nothing. When they hear what I say, they will not understand. Otherwise, they would turn to me and be forgiven.' Then Jesus said, 'If you can't understand the meaning of this parable, how will you understand all the other parables? The farmer plants seed by taking God's word to others. The seed that fell on the footpath represents those who hear the message only to have Satan come at once and take it away. The seed on the rocky soil or shallow soil represents those who hear the message and immediately receive it with joy. But since they don't have deep roots, they don't last long. They fall away as soon as they have problems or are persecuted for believing God's word. We'll conclude our reading there. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. We read some, you know, cautions, some warnings. If we stay where we're at spiritually, if we never go deeper, we won't survive the elements. For the seed in Jesus' parable, it was the hot sun that scorched the tender plants. For us, it's probably a severe wind that shows up in the middle of the country in the middle of summer, or a pandemic, or a job loss, or a relationship that hasn't gone the way we hoped, or one of a thousand other things that just don't go quite right in life. Last week, we learned that, you know, those are the kinds of things, the disappointments in life are what keep non-believers hardened to the gospel. But I think those same things cause believers to kind of to lose their faith. Jesus adds one more that's, you know, kind of troubling. Persecution. And he makes it clear, you know, in the Gospels and throughout the New Testament that Christians will suffer for their faith. And most believers throughout history and throughout the world have paid a price because of their faith in Jesus Christ. They've lost jobs or, you know, relationships or limbs. We've had it maybe far too easy for far too long. I'm kind of afraid that those days are coming to an end. Maybe we're already experiencing some of the losses that come from our faith in Jesus Christ. But reality is, when hardships come, when it becomes, you know, costly to believe in Jesus, many will fall away because they're shallow in their faith. So we won't survive the challenges that come from just normal life, let alone the hardships that are around the corner. I also think we learned that, you know, if we're not growing, if we're not falling more in love with Jesus Christ, we'll never have the joy that he offers to us. We have it in the beginning, we read, and we'll talk about in a bit. It's what happens in us, the weight of the sin being lifted from us, the joy of peace with God. But if we walk away, if we, you know, put forth minimal effort in a relationship with Jesus, I don't think we live with that joy, that peace, that contentment. I thought of the parable of the prodigal son in Luke 15. I believe that the son enjoyed, you know, the peace, the joy, the well-being in his home, in his father's house. He had everything he was looking for in life, but part of him wondered if there was something else out there, if there was more to life than this. He thought happiness, you know, was something that had eluded him. So he went after it. He chased after it. And there were moments where he was having a good time, you know, experiencing pleasure and joy. Well, maybe not joy, but happiness. But eventually it ran out. He realized that, you know, what he left behind was way better than anything else he'd experienced. He had the sense to return home to the Father, return to that place of joy and intimacy with God. That's available to us. That's what God wants for us, a life of enjoying his presence now, and it'll last forever. But why do we choose to remain shallow, to put forth minimal effort in our relationship with Jesus? Some thoughts this morning. We're functioning by feelings. to acknowledge it feels good to be forgiven. You remember that day when the weight of sin was lifted from you? And, you know, joy and peace flooded into your heart. I mean, there's no feeling like that. I remember that day. But those emotions, those feelings really aren't sustainable. Feels good to be forgiven, but being forgiven, living a Christian life, doesn't always feel good. Sometimes it's hard work. Sometimes it's dry and you know, barren. Great Christian writer talked about the dark night of the soul, and sometimes it's just hard to live for Jesus. Those who live by feelings aren't going to survive the down times, the valleys that are inevitable in life. Martin Luther was a great Christian leader a few centuries ago, was maybe the first person to acknowledge that feelings come and feelings go. And we're human. We will feel strongly for a while. Feelings come and feelings go. And he goes on to say, but feelings are deceiving. You can't trust your emotions. You can't let your feelings dictate your behavior. But he says, I've placed my faith in the word of the Lord. Nothing else is worth believing. Can't function by feelings if we're going to grow, if we're going to flourish as Christians. Another challenge we face is we're failing to fertilize. Without spiritual food, we won't flourish as believers. Just like physically, if we're not eating, we're in trouble. I visit, you know, some of our people when they're hospitalized, and man, one of the crucial steps if they're ever going to go home is they're eating regularly. Food is fuel. I think we get that. We know what, well, maybe we don't know what it would be like to go extended period of time without eating. But most Christians, at least in our country, try to do that. Some statistics I came upon this week. 54% of U.S. adults attended church a decade ago. Now it's down to 45%, which seems pretty good. That was probably pre-derecho. But it doesn't tell us the frequency of church attendance. And what I've heard is regular church attendance in today's standards is you come once a month. Now, don't get any ideas that contending that's not enough to flourish. We can't go a week without a meal. Maybe more troubling is that 1 in 3 evangelicals, people like us who get what Jesus has done for us, that we were lost until he found us, 1 in 3 have quit attending church altogether. Also learned that, this was a little more depressing, but only 14% of adults in the United States read their Bibles daily. That was as of a year ago. In just a year, that number has dropped to 9%. And I also learned that just since the pandemic began, we've dropped another 0.5%, 8.5% of adults are reading the Bible, you know, on a regular basis. At a time when so many aren't able to come to church, at a time when we would expect people to be looking to God's word for help, for nourishment, they're looking to other things. We need ongoing nourishment if we're going to grow. Lastly, why are we remaining in the shallows? It's because we've forgotten God's favor. We've lost sight of how much he's done for us in Christ Jesus. And that thought of the price he paid for our redemption should be enough to motivate us to want to spend time in his house and in his word and among his people. when we get how much he's loved us, then how can we help but love him back and seek him and try to get to know him better? We need to ponder that. We need to praise him for that. I used to carry a nail in my pocket, and I don't know why I stopped. Because it's good to remember the price Jesus paid for my salvation and for yours. When we remember that, when we live with that sense of awe and gratitude, then it's only natural to want to get to know him better, but we forget. So what can we do about it? How can we go deeper? How can we flourish as Christians? How can we rise above the trend to be half-hearted, to dabble in the things of God? We need to get rooted in God's love. Paul says to the Ephesian Christians, your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. He talks in that passage about the height, the depth, the breadth, the width of God's love, and how, when again, we internalize that, it does something to us. My favorite sermon from the Awakening prayer conference that I attended in Texas was all about this love. Dana Candler suggested that being rooted, being grounded in God's love is the most stabilizing thing in our lives. If we get that love, if we internalize it, if we live in love with him, then we'll never fall away. But how do we do that? How do we get God's love? How do we better comprehend how much we are loved? We get the being side. We are loved by God. We are his children. We need to contemplate that. But then we've got to do something. Avail ourselves to these great, timeless disciplines. The kinds of things Christians have been doing since the time of Christ. You could list them. Prayer, talking to God, having, you know, conversations with him about what's going on in our lives, asking his opinion about what, you know, he wants us to be doing. Bible reading, Bible study. His written word is the primary means by which we get to know him better and understand his love. And other disciplines such as worship and serving, fasting, the sacraments. These means of grace have helped Christians since the time of Christ. They're available to us, you know, at any point to fertilize, to nurture that relationship with Jesus. It's hard work being a disciple. It's hard work spiritually adulting. But we want to grow. We want to flourish. We want to bear fruit as believers. And he offers these means to us. One of the means that I want to focus on for a minute. Well, almost forgot this verse. Great verse from 1 Peter. Like newborn babies, you must crave pure spiritual milk so that you will grow into a full experience of salvation. Cry out for this nourishment now that you have had a taste of the Lord's kindness. Well, another means of grace that's been particularly challenging for the last few months is Christian community, connecting with other believers, fellowship. Not just, you know, sharing a cup of coffee, but sharing life together, sharing joys and sorrows and prayer requests and struggles is vital to Christian flourishing. We read on the day of Pentecost when the church was new, you know, when people were just getting to know Jesus. 3,000 trusted Christ, 3,000 men and women who had come from different backgrounds and different cultures. They didn't have churches on every corner. They didn't have Bibles yet, at least the New Testament scriptures. How did they survive? And they didn't just survive. They changed the world. They met together every day. Probably not a realistic goal for us. But true Christian community, coming together to worship, to pray, to share, enabled them to not just survive. When persecution came, when Emperor Nero brought the hammer down on those early Christians, but they took the gospel everywhere. They produced much fruit. Talk about that in a couple weeks. What is possible for growing Christians? We can change the world. Have you seen the redwoods, those giant trees that mainly grow on the West Coast? Pictures don't do them justice. They can grow up to 350 feet tall. That's longer than a football field. They can be 24 inches in diameter and weigh up to 800 tons. And you'd probably suspect that to grow a tree so massive, you'd have to have a root system like the size of a skyscraper underneath the ground. I mean, those things are just enormous. So much weight, so much mass. They have to have significant root systems to survive. And they do. But their roots don't go down deep. They go out sideways. The key to growing these massive trees that survive for centuries is their connection with each other. Their roots intertwine with each other, and they find strength in community, in being among other trees. They survive the storms of life. They grow taller and live longer than any other tree. We need each other. That's a challenge. Think of our live stream audience. How can you experience Christian community when you're stuck at home? We've offered some Zoom classes. We started a new Sunday school class, well, a Tuesday evening class this past week, and it's on improving our race relations, called the third option, and I'm sure that'll be great. But man, as I participated, it was just good to see other people, to be talking about important matters with people, who are open and honest about their own struggles. If you're interested in being a part of a Zoom class, a remote Bible study, let us know. We tried a few, but we'll try more. If there is interest in participating in community, we'll make a way. No matter where you are, we'll make a way, right? That's my promise. So let us know in your comments on the live stream, and we'll be in touch with you in coming days. One final suggestion for going deeper, and this probably should be the first thing we say in our gospel presentations, because maybe we communicate that it's just a little prayer you pray, and you invite Jesus into your heart, and you go on your merry way. But Jesus makes it clear that being a believer, being a Christian, is an all-in prospect. We follow Jesus, not just on Sundays, not just when we feel like it. We follow him fully. Love the Lord your God with your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. That's about all we need to know. There's a place for emotion. We're created as emotional beings, and I love those moments of intimacy with Jesus, those moments in worship when, the tears fall, or I feel so close to him. I celebrate them. But we need to live for Jesus, even when the emotions fade. We exercise our minds, our wills. We make the choice to follow Jesus no matter what's happening in my life, no matter how I feel. No turning back. And a lot of it comes down to what we do day in and day out, the choices we make, the way we spend our time, is vital to growing deep roots, to becoming a strong, stable Christian that won't fall away. That's what Jesus wants for us. And he's helping us. He's giving us opportunities like this to hear the truth and respond. And maybe some need to do that. We're going to sing a closing song. And if you've been half-hearted, if you've been lukewarm, if you've been content to dabble in the faith, to live in the shallows, I hope you hear him say today, you're never going to make it if that's as far as you're willing to go. But he has a life of joy and fruitfulness available for all of us if we'll follow him. So God, we thank you for your word and this great parable that speaks to every one of us at different points, God. And as burdened as I am for Christians today, I can't imagine how you feel as you witness so many falling away. And I think they have good excuses because life's been hard and it hasn't gone the way they want, but I'm sure your heart aches for them. As you see them flounder, as you see them try to fill the void with other things, when you have what they're looking for, you have what we're looking for, intimacy with you, peace and hope and real joy that only comes from you. You're there saying, I can help you with this. God, I pray that seed has been scattered today and may it find receptive soil. God, I know the enemy will do all he can to steal the seed on a Sunday like this, the second we walk out that door, may go back to life as normal. Don't let him win this battle today. Help us to see you love us too much to let us flounder and wither. You offer us all the grace we need to grow, to become strong, to survive any storm that life or the enemy throws at us. So help us to receive it today. Help the seed to take deep root within us, God. May it inform what we do tomorrow as we get up and perhaps give you some quality time as we say yes to opportunities to love people, to serve them. God, help us to build our lives upon Jesus. He is the only sure foundation. Just draw us closer to yourself this day, we pray. If you want to come and pray just by yourself at the altar as we sing, you're welcome to do so.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever bring. For you, oh. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, you're worthy of every breath we could ever be. We live for you. Oh, we live for you, and you are holy. There is no one like you, there is none. beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Let's sing Worthy together.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. So worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Live for you. Oh. Oh, Jesus, a name above every other name. And Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And you are holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
We are the church.
Passionately worshiping.
Transforming our community.
Thanking.
Adoring. Submitting.
Loving one another.
United in Christ.
Interceding for our cities.
Praying for each other.
Celebrating our hope.
Proclaiming truth.
Sharing joy and sorrow.
Tearing down walls that divide.
Making disciples.
Exalting Jesus.
Anyone registered yet for evening worship? All right, we got two out there. It's an awesome night. Limited seating for social distancing, but 3 weeks from tonight, we'll gather together at First Open Bible Church. It's 6 o'clock. And there'll also be a live stream option, so I just encourage you all to set your calendars for this important event as we, the Christians of our county, come together to worship and pray. And if you are interested in showing up in person, go to the Serve the City website and register, because I'm sure those spaces will fill quickly. All right, baptism, 2 weeks from today. It'll take place at 10:45, so please come a little early. You'll want to support those being baptized. And we said at that time, so first service crowd, those who go to Sunday school can also participate. So, and if you missed the preparation class today but are interested, please see me. I'll get you ready. Don't miss out on this opportunity to undergo this awesome sacrament. We continue to make multiple giving options available. Thank you all, live crowd and online, for your faithful support. You can leave gifts in the offering boxes or text to give or give online or mail them in. So continue to put God first with your gifts. And, the alabaster offering we're collecting this month, this great missions offering, there's a box in back for your change boxes or whatever else you want to put in, as long as it's money. Anyway, I'd like to pray for us as we close this service to bring our needs before the Lord and invite you to stand as we do so. So God, I thank you for this day and for these who've come out and those who've joined in on our live stream and pray that they have heard your voice today. And may your word continue to do its work in our hearts, God. Make us the people you want us to be. And that includes being representatives of Jesus wherever the path takes us. So God, just fill us up with your love, with your truth, with your grace, so we have something to give those we'll encounter this week. God, we thank you for watching over us. Jen's doing better. Trudy still needs your touch, but we know you're with her, God. And we just trust you for the healing that's needed in their bodies. And be with others, Lord, who are feeling poorly. And those facing surgeries, God, just keep them safe so they can have operations upcoming. And God, be at work where there's financial need and relationship need. And be near to those who are discouraged or distressed. Lord, continue to bless our students as they navigate to these challenging times, and our teachers as well, God, as they're trying to do the best they can. Get our schools ready, Lord, so they can go back. And keep them safe, God. Keep your hand upon our kids and all of us. And may we not be anxious, because you care about us and you're with us. We lift our nation to you, Lord, that you would guide us through this election season. Deliver us from being unkind and from just warring against each other. And we pray you'll raise up the right person to lead our nation. And all our leaders will realize how desperately they need you. They need your wisdom. They need your truth. So help us during this time. Have mercy on our nation, God. Be with those who've suffered from another hurricane and those who are facing fires. And show us how we can alleviate suffering. God, may we leave here with your peace and the confidence of knowing that you're bigger than whatever we face. We love you and pray all this in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you all for being here and for joining us. Go in peace.